This year's winter is great for our reservoirs, great for the drought, but man, has it been tough on our wildlife here in Utah. Hey, I'm Adam Eagle. Thanks for tuning in. Yeah, it is extremely tough, especially in northern Utah, for our deer, elk, and even moose. And so tonight we're gonna dive into some of the questions. What parts of the states are doing okay? What parts got hit hard? How's it looking? What about tag numbers for hunters coming up? We're gonna talk to biologists, managers with the DWR, even BYU professors to see what their data is showing them.
We are headed to Anderton Canyon where we've had a collared deer die. It's been unprecedented. We probably have had the harshest winter conditions we've ever had on recorded history for Morgan Southridge specifically.
The most dead deer I saw in a single hike to go retrieve a collar was like 33 dead deer.
Utah has 194 wildlife management areas across the state.
She's out on this hillside.
Many of these are closed during the winter to protect wintering wildlife. The Hennifer Echo WMA is one of those. And this year, with the heavy snow and cold temperatures, it is full of both deer and elk. And many have died or are dying.
Instead of just having deer eating the vegetation, now we've got deer and elk eating, competing for the same stuff, essentially. And while their diets are typically different, there's still a little bit of overlap. And in the winter, when there's nothing else to eat, that overlap becomes bigger. There's a lot more competition for the same thing. So I'm gonna do a full necropsy on her. She probably died of malnutrition, but we'll just cut in and make sure her organs look normal.
This doe is one of thousands of animals that have been collared as part of a migration and survival study conducted by the DWR and BYU.
She died last night between 7 and 9 p.m.
When the doe stopped moving, the GPS collar alerted Zayla that the doe was most likely dead.
It's been rough. We're seeing, right now I'm sitting at about 37% adult survival on mule deer in this unit.
60 some odd percent of dead died.
Yep.
We definitely are seeing more snow that's holding on longer than we've seen in decades. And on our units where we have higher elevation winter ranges, or we have limited winter range, or on some of the units where maybe we had too many mouths on the landscape, we were over our objectives, we're seeing some pretty severe negative impacts on some of those units.
Dak says some of the hardest hit units this winter are the Cache, Camas, Chalk Creek, and East Canyon units. The Wasatch Back area, like around Heber and Walsburg, and the eastern portion of the Uinta Basin near Vernal got hit hard as well, but nothing quite like the Morgan Southridge units.
And the numbers are preliminary. We're still tracking it. We're not done yet. But on like the worst ones, like the Morgan Southridge, we're looking at adult doe loss probably in the 60% range. And your older age class bucks, they're also vulnerable. So you're talking your, you know, 7, 8, 9 year old and older bucks. A lot of those bucks are probably not making it through this winter. And fawns they're gone. Yeah, on those units.
Now, it's not all bad news. In central and southern Utah, deer populations are actually growing. On the Monroe unit in central Utah and on the Zion and Pine Valley units in southern Utah, doe and fawn survival is high. The deer down south have been struggling due to drought, and this winter has been a welcome sight to deer and biologists. Dak says the DWR recommendations for deer permits this year will reflect the population decline in northern and northeastern units.
We're going to see some pretty substantial cuts on some of these units in northern Utah. A lot of units in the central part of the state, permit numbers are going to probably stay pretty similar to what they've been. And we're going to propose some increases, some pretty substantial increases, even on some of those units in southern Utah where this water is just making a giant difference and the deer are doing great.
We're not out of the woods yet. Dak says in some of these harder hit areas, deer are still going to die, even though spring has finally sprung.
As this snow melts and we transition to green feed, some of these animals that have just been getting by, eating whatever twigs they could find, you know, they're just a real limited amount of nutrition available to them. Their digestive system, the microflora in their gut that helps them get calories out of food, has declined to the point that when they transition back to green feed, when we start getting green up, their digestive system can't make that transition. It's declined to a point where that we will literally see animals die when we go to green up, and they'll die with a belly full of green feed. It's just too much for them to handle, and they can't get calories out of it. By the end of April, I think we'll have a really good idea of where we're at, but we will see mortality continue through the month of April.
The cause of mortality was malnutrition.
This 5.5-year-old doe that was carrying twins just couldn't get enough nutrition this year. And it's not just deer that are dying. Coming up, we'll dive into the elk population, show you how biologists determine malnutrition, and take a closer look at BYU's collar study.
Welcome back to KSL Outdoors. You know, Utah is on the forefront with their wildlife initiative where they've collared thousands of deer and elk with GPS collars in partnership with BYU. We decided to stop and talk to Randy Larson, who's co-chairs this department, and talk to him and learn a little bit about the data that they're seeing this year.
This is an elk-sized collar based on the band, but this battery will do about 4.5 years with a location every 2 hours.
In 2014, BYU, the DWR, and conservation partners like SFW launched an aggressive monitoring program for deer, elk, and other wildlife.
You want this collar?
Since then, they've collared thousands of animals to better understand movement patterns, habitat use, migration, survival, and cause of death. This collar study has helped the DWR with its big game management.
Unprecedented, more than any other state that I'm aware of, and a real investment by Utah to try and manage and understand what's going on out there.
Doe and fawns are what drive deer populations. We only need a few bucks to sustain a herd, so a lot of emphasis has been made to collar doe and fawns. Since 2015, Utah fawns have had a survival rate right around 50% in the state. This year, things were looking okay until about February, when fawns started tipping over.
And this is our current line, current as of this morning, right?
Tracking
there.
Tracking towards, yeah. Lower than 50%.
Tracking probably those bottom three. You can go north to south, and here's Cache. That's our toughest spot with where we have fawns, but you can see that's going to be a low year. But then on the bright side would be something like Pine Valley, where
it's hot. Yeah, high as you've had in
high as we've ever had. Utah's interesting. It's never like good everywhere.
Yeah,
it's always good in one spot, bad in another. It's drought or winter. After doing all this monitoring or being a part of this big monitoring effort, I fear drought more than winter. We will lose some deer. We will have, you know, a complete loss of fawns in some units. But the landscape's going to be rejuvenated, the habitat is going to be refreshed, and the animals will bounce back.
Deer dying because of malnutrition probably didn't surprise very many people, but I do think the elk dying is a surprise. Elk are usually pretty hardy animals.
We've lost several on the WMA this year, and it's probably pretty indicative that the habitat can't support the number of animals we've got on the landscape. Yeah, we're sitting between 40 and 50 bulls that we know of have died of malnutrition.
It is a little bit surprising. Elk are doing much better in this winter. They usually do. So we've got pretty high survival rates on elk, except for Morgan Southridge, where we've had some mortality. But even there, you would be 80%+ on your survival.
So what's a good way to tell that a deer or elk has died from malnutrition? You take a look at the bone marrow.
That one's really turning red. It's got that gelatinous texture. But when we find an animal that, you know, all the clues add up, their skin and bones, you can feel their hip bones, their spine sticking out, their marrow's bright red, you can tell that's what got them, you know.
Don't you believe?
Well, look, here's a healthy one.
Yeah, that was a good one.
Healthy deer that's not nutritionally stressed. This is a deer that was doing okay, making it through the winter just fine. This is a deer that was metabolizing its own bone marrow to stay alive. So it means they're kind of on their last leg. They've taken all the nutrition they can possibly get from the environment. They're not getting any calories out of the feed. They've burned all their body fat. And it's to that point where they start, honestly, just their body almost starts eating itself.
The DWR and Sportsman's Group started feeding deer in early January. So far, over $300,000 has been spent on just feed. That doesn't include the amount of time and effort that's gone into feeding the deer. The shed hunting season was delayed until May 1st, and the DWR also closed 24 WMAs in northern and central Utah until May 1st to protect wintering wildlife.
And I think it's maybe part of these natural cycles. You have a year like this that's going to kill a lot of your older animals, weaker, sicker animals. And then I'm just hoping after this, we get that flush on our habitats and we keep working on addressing limiting factors, predator management, doing habitat improvement, water availability, working to try to minimize roadkill. We're just going to keep working on those things and roll with what we're given, but we'll do the best with it.
Well, it's good to hear it's not all doom and gloom.
Yeah.
Across the state anyway.
It's a mixed bag.
Yeah, I guess a lot of guys maybe have some points, may want to consider hunting central or southern Utah this year.
Things look really good down there. It's going to be rough. We're going to be rebuilding in the north for a little while.
Yeah, and you guys, it sounds like you said about 1,400 tags statewide reduction.
Yep. Statewide, when you factor in the cuts, you know, some pretty substantial cuts up north, but some pretty substantial increases down south. Net, it comes out, it's less than a 2% change. I think we're cutting around 1,400 permits total.
Hey, don't forget the shed antler closure until May 1st. Some of those WMAs up north are probably not gonna open up until May 1st as well, so make sure you check those out before you venture onto those properties. Even if you think they're open, they may not be open. Hey, I'm Adam Eagle, KSL Outdoors, reminding you to get out with your family, your friends, make some memories outdoors. We'll see you next weekend, good night.